At the moment of me recording this, there are about 3,200 confirmed exoplanets, with 2,235 of them having been found and confirmed by Kepler. If you want to learn more about astronomy and futurism, make sure you subscribe and turn on the bell notifications so you don't miss anything. But how does Kepler find all these exoplanets? Well, Kepler has a photometer, an instrument that measures brightness with a lens almost a meter wide, and it being the largest camera we've ever sent into space. This photometer is not on a small scale either. Kepler constantly measures and has been measuring the brightness of about 150,000 stars in a portion of our region of the Milky Way galaxy. Kepler's fixed field of view contains sections of the constellations Cygnus, Lyra, and Draco, and all of these stars exist in the Kepler Input Catalogue, or more commonly known as KIC. You may think, oh, just stick a good telescope at a star and look for planets, but unfortunately, it's not that easy, and so that's not how Kepler finds these exoplanets, because planets outside our solar system are far too small and too far away from us to see, even with our best telescopes, but we can see stars much better than planets. When a celestial object, usually a planet, passes in front of a star while it's orbiting that star, it's an event called a transit. Occasionally, we see transits of Mercury or Venus here from Earth. And while the planet passes in front of the star, it blocks a small percentage of the light from the star. The size of the dip in brightness reflects the size of the object. And basically, Kepler, using its photometer, is looking at all these 150,000 stars and seeing if there's a dip in the star's brightness, which most likely suggests that something passed in front of it. And if there is a dip in brightness in one of the stars, then Kepler records it and then sends it to Earth. Kepler used this technique to find more about the TRAPPIST planetary system you might have heard about in the news. And because transits last for quite a short time, Kepler has to measure each star quite often, so their brightnesses are measured once every few hours. After it's been detected, the size of the planet's orbit can be calculated from how long it takes the planet to orbit once and the mass of the star, which uses Kepler's third law of planetary motion. The planet's size can be worked out from how much the brightness dropped and the star's size, and using the orbital size and the temperature of the star, the characteristic temperature of the planet can be worked out. Using this information, we can now see if the planet is habitable or not. But it's not as simple and straightforward as it seems. There are three things that we do need. First of all, you need the planet's orbital plane to be tilted towards Kepler. You wouldn't see any dip in the star's brightness if you're directly over or under the sun's poles. And unfortunately, this is the case for most of the stars that Kepler looks at. A common misconception of the universe is that everything is in line with each other or flat. This is not the case. Second, the solar system in question has to actually have at least one sufficiently sized planet that is big enough or close enough to its star for the star's brightness to noticeably dim. A passing planet will block no more than 1%, and anything close to 1% or even over it must be quite a large body. For instance, Jupiter would make a 1% drop, and planets don't get much larger than Jupiter. The third necessity is for the dip in brightness to be periodic, meaning for the dip to be regular. For instance, maybe the planet orbits the star every 7 days. This would mean the dip in brightness would happen every 7 days. If you notice a periodic dip, then it proves that something is orbiting the star. Especially if the dip in brightness is the exact same as the one before. It also proves that it's not just a passing rogue comet or something, because something that is not orbiting the star wouldn't cause a regular dip in brightness. The risky business with this is that the planet could take centuries to orbit its star, so Kepler wouldn't see a regular dip with planets that have an orbital period as large as Pluto's, for example. It takes 248 years to orbit the sun once. The annoying thing about this is that in all the solar systems where they do have these three necessities, there is still a possibility that it's not an exoplanet, because it could be a binary star system. A binary star system, simply put, is where you have two stars that orbit each other. And so the Kepler science team go through all the recorded dips and see what ones are actually planets and what ones aren't. Binary star systems are the most common phenomenon that causes a dip in brightness, but then turn out they aren't planets. And unfortunately for the Kepler science team, binary star systems are really common. I will upload part 3 next week, so be on the lookout for that. If you enjoyed this video, check out part 3 of the series, which will be here once it's uploaded, or this playlist. Also, remember to subscribe for more content. Thank you so much for watching, I'll see you later.